Ambrose. Ford. It's all good, man.
John Bell, Spikey, you made all the best today. We've got our money on you, and hopefully you do the job for us.
I think Scaife's going to win this weekend.
You sure about that?
Yeah, bro, yeah.
Murph, this is your playground. Do us proud. Beat the Aussies.
Well, Greg Murphy at the moment overall on points is on 144 points thanks to that victory in race two as they warm up now for the final race here at Pukekohe. I think we can expect some fireworks because we've got some very fast cars at the front and the back of the grid. Let's go through it on your Nintendo GameCube starting grid. There it is. Murphy versus Bright at the front. Ambrose and Todd Kelly will start from 3 and 4. Rick Kelly, the Holden Young line, from 5. Stephen Richards in 6. Neil Crompton starts in 7. The yellow boxes indicate where they qualified and then at the end of race 2, so you can see exactly where they've been moving up and down. Bradley Jones in 13th position, dropped a couple after race 2. Jason Richards, the local hope, will start. There we go. 17 down to 20 takes us down to John Bow. Paul Wheel in 21. Anthony Tratt, Bernard back in 23. And there is Mark Scaife. The winner of race 1, the man who had pole position, will start from 28th on the grid. Look out for him as the 5-time series champion tries to work his way through the field as they warm up. Let's check in with Rusty. Greg?
Well, guys, the car came in during the warm-up just prior to this race. They have checked the engine. The way they worked on it was fantastic. They've cable-tied a few little hoses, and it is OK. Also, an incident between Todd Kelly and Stephen Richards from the previous race may be under investigation.
Well, the engine Greg Rust was talking about was, of course, the engine in Mark Scaife's car. He went out early in race 2. The team believes it's a top-end failure, maybe a valve spring or something like that. So they've done the engine change.
OK, here we go. The crowd stands up. It's a really big crowd here at Pukekohe. Perfect race conditions for the final race of the day. And Jason Bright looks to have got a bit of a jump on Greg Murphy, but Murphy pulls him back. The big mover is Todd Kelly into turn 1. It's a Kmart 1-2 to start the race.
Oh, look at this. 00 Motorsport Falcon way offline there. Might be Neil Crompton as the field push their way through.
Oh, big spin from Brad Jones and Jason Richards. Through the Boost Mobile S as they go, and Bradley Jones comes a cropper again.
See, one of the Valvoline Cummins cars was in trouble as well. So the field sort themselves out as they thunder down the back straight for the first time. Kmart 1-2, Greg Murphy in command from his teammate Todd Kelly. Just a little lock brake on the inside there from Greg Murphy. A few puffs of smoke from a few lock tyres. 2-00 Motorsport Falcons in the middle of that battle. Crompton has in fact pushed his way through in front of Craig Lowndes. So Crompton on a charge. He's made up 20 positions so far from 2 races.
He's a man on a mission this weekend, Neil Crompton. The 2 better electrical cars go through. What a start from Todd Kelly.
And there's Mark Scaife. Stuck in the pack there, expect Scaife to come in for a stop very early. Let's have a look at this Nintendo replay of that first corner.
Oh, Jason Richards just went straight across the grass.
T-boned.
Rejoined the track. That's exactly right, Mark. T-boned Brad Jones in car 21. One of the Castrol cars, that'd be Larry Perkins at the back of the pack. Takes some action. Wow, to get out of the way.
Well, Mark Scaife has moved up to 20th position already, but I'd expect Scaife to come in and pit as early as possible. He doesn't want to get caught up in this queue. He wants to get in, get his fresh tyres on and get out in clean air. Try and make plenty of track time up with no cars around him. Here they come out of the hairpin. The field still shuffling. Plenty of elbows out door to door as they settle down into their rhythm. Up through Ford Mountain. 0-2, Rick Kelly. Done a great job this weekend for the Holden Young Lions team.
Glenn
Seaton.
Problems
there for Seaton.
That's Glenn Seaton.
Been a tangle further back in the pack. Yeah, look at it, and look at the damage.
Sorry, black flag.
Talk about black flag.
Get black flag, we'll come in and pull it off.
Okay, the team warning Glenn, he may get black flag for that loose bodywork, but I think that's just saved him the trouble. Black flag not needed. The bodywork has flown off the back. So Seaton now not considered a hazard to the rest of the cars on the track, but he's dropped right to the back of the field.
I just wonder what happened to the rear of that car if it got off the track as it flew off.
That was a big hit. Look at the damage on the left rear corner there on the Ford Credit Falcon. So, really miserable weekend for Glenn Seaton. Look at that, the big fuel tank. 120 litres of fuel hanging down the back there. Let's have a look on the replay.
That's Holden Hairpin. He's been completely turned around and then collected by Cameron McLean on the way out. So the VIP car just sliced the rear off as it goes around. Now watch Seaton there on the left of your screen, car number five. He gets turned around. I think Craig Baird might have been involved in that. And
Anthony
then
Trout as well.
Slice. Off it goes. The rear is left dangling.
Well, Baird and Trout were just virtually level pegging into that turn. It could have been either of those cars that turned the Ford Credit Falcon around. Here's the battle back at the front. Greg Murphy, fastest lap so far, 58.68. And here come the cars in for their compulsory stops. Craig Baird, Team Brock choosing to stop early. Same with the Lansvale Racing Team. Scaife up to 14th, so Scaife has not chosen to come in yet because he's still making up lots of positions.
Those are the cars that were involved in that little tangle. This one wasn't Rick Kelly, 02, the Holden Young line. He's in and out, tyre preservation. Be absolutely crucial, and I know that Greg Russ was checking out the state of the tyres before this race. Rusty, what have you got for us on the tyre scene? You were telling us that Greg Murphy's in pretty good shape.
Certainly is, guys. I've spoken to Robbie Crawford down at Kmart Racing. He tells me they have got a set of tyres which they are going to put on after Greg Murphy's stop, which have only done three laps this weekend. They've deliberately saved them for this final race. They lightly rode them and they're ready for action. Now, Rick Kelly came in for his stop just moments ago. They told Mark Scaife to stay out for an extra lap. Here he is now in pit lane. Mark Scaife standing by for a stop.
Yeah, well, he's got 12 really good sets of tyres. 12 good tyres, I should say. Three sets, because the car has been using its tyres so effectively. He has just got an enormous amount of rubber to choose from. You can make sure that car will have the four best out of the bunch as he goes after the leaders in this race. Here he comes. Engine problems in race two. Now he's back in action for three.
Rick, good slick stop by the looks of things so far. Mark, get out. A bit of traffic here in pit lane behind him. Rodney Forbes and Tony Longhurst. So Scaife on the charge.
This will be interesting to see what progress he can make through the field as he rejoins. Made tremendous progress from the back of the field up to about 14th place before he came in for his stop. So he's got nothing to lose now. He's got to go for it and see how close to the top he can climb in the remaining laps. He's got a long way to go. Lap six of 54. For the order of the moment, Murphy. Todd Kelly, 1.1 seconds behind his teammate. Jason Wright in third. Ambrose in fourth. Richards in fifth. Richards in race two was diagnosed with a faulty left rear shock absorber. The team rebuilt. That could have been the reason for his difficulties with handling in race two. Here's David Maher, gear linkage problems early in race two, took him right out of contention. And a long stop here. Stone Brothers team. Darryl?
Yeah, I was standing and Bernard just came past pit line. The car looked fine, but the front right-hand tyre was half flat. It's obviously on its way down.
Rick Kelly, fastest man on the circuit. He's just done a 58.46. He's closed right up on the back of the 00 Motorsport Ford.
Yeah, Craig Lowndes came shooting out of pit lane. Grant Denyer's in there as Greg Murphy pulls in.
Bit of a late change. It was supposed to be Todd Kelly to come in. A slight delay on the back of the tyre. They held him there. They thought some traffic was on its way. So a slightly longer stop, probably 2 seconds longer than it really had to be.
Well, the time's starting to slip out. Here comes Jason Bright, second of the Holden Racing Team Commodores. So everyone getting these stops out of the way early. Tyre durability. The tyres don't wear here, they just get hot.
Watch it go down pit lane, Stoner right.
So he's come out after Greg Murphy. Car 51 just beat car 2, the Holden Racing Team, to the punch. So Murphy rejoins the battle. Todd Kelly still out there. Marcus Ambrose in second. Stephen Richards in third. Trying to make as much time up as they can while they've got some clear track conditions. 58.8, fastest time for Kelly. 58.8 for Ambrose, Richards. The fastest time in this race, a 58.35 from Mark Scaife. He's just put that time in on his fresh set of tyres. Here's Todd Kelly. Grant?
Yeah, Todd's been complaining on the sighting lap of a bad vibration. He's hoping it might have been just a dud tyre, but obviously the change of sets now will help that with a much quicker stop than Greg Murphy's.
Marcus Ambrose in as well at Stone Brothers.
We'll see how this stop goes, guys. Everything looking good for Marcus Ambrose so far. At the end of this stop, we'll show you the tyre which came off David Bernard's car. Ambrose hits the deck, gets out in front of Todd Kelly. Good stop by the Stone Brothers Racing Team, but we'll show you this tyre. This is the one that's come off the right front of David Bernard's car. Now, Darryl picked it before. He said it looked as though it was deflating for some reason. Have a look at this tyre. He apparently coming down towards the hairpin was trying to avoid some debris on the circuit, had a brake lockup, and that is the result.
Unbelievable, isn't it? Trying to limp it home with the tyre in that condition.
Shredded to bits.
TWR Australia Commodores trading fastest laps. It was Scaife now. Rick Kelly's brought it down again. 58.27. Fastest lap in race one was a 57.45. A 57.9 in race two, a 58.2. So you can see the drivers now starting to get down into some used tyre stock. Oh, problems here for Stephen Ellery.
Well, he's taken that tyre barrier off turn one, so he's come through to make his way into the Mobile S's and ended up taking the tyre barrier completely with him on the front left. Stephen Ellery in car 31 tries to reverse out of that mess. Meanwhile, the action continues in pit lane. Car 16, Stephen Richards is in and out. And Stephen Ellery is trying to get out of the gravel.
Well, it looks like he's going to do it under his own steam, which is great. Have to call a safety car out. Car 34, Garth Tander comes in for his stop. The first 57 we've seen. And Murphy does have a red-hot set of tyres on that Kmart Commodore. 57.97. The first man to drop into the 57s in race three.
Expect quite a fair bit of damage to the front left.
Stephen Ellery reporting into his crew. So, summing into the 57s, Greg Murphy is looking good. Look at this contact here between Craig Lowndes and Rick Kelly. Kelly on a charge, 270 k's up the inside of the 00 Motorsport Ford. And he takes him into the hairpin. Lowndes will try the switch back here. Kelly's got him covered. You can see Lowndes grappling for traction. Stephen Richards going right up on the curbs in car 16. And Mark Scaife trying to pick his way through the melee. So Greg Murphy at the moment is moving his way up through the queue. He is the fastest, or at the front of the queue of the cars that have made their compulsory stops. Jason Bright will be in behind him.
And Marcus Ambrose will also be behind Bright. So really, the race order at the moment, if you bring pit stops into play, we'll have Murphy leading it, then Bright, and then Ambrose. Here Stephen Ellery comes in. He told the crew to expect some front left damage. Doesn't appear to be too bad because they're just doing a tyre change there and checking out the damage at the same time. Doesn't look as bad as first thought. So Ingle, Jones and Seaton yet to pit. Murphy has, Wright has, so has Ambrose. Todd Kelly, Rick Kelly has come out firing. So too has Craig Lowndes. Mark Scaife there started from 28th position and is mowing his way through the field. What a start to race three. They're determined to leave Pukekohe smoking behind them. The V8 Supercars in New Zealand. Well, in a matter of minutes, it's gone from okay to really bad for Stephen Ellery. They've found some major trouble there. It didn't look too bad when he came in. He told them to expect it. We thought that it wasn't as bad as first thought, but now Stephen Ellery is out of the car.
Looks like he's damaged the engine's cooling system. There's a lot of green coolant dripping all over the pit apron there. Greg Rust?
You're exactly right, Mark. There is coolant spilling from underneath that car. I'm just wondering why it may have occurred, whether it's overheated perhaps on the run back into pit lane. We'll try and find out for you.
Greg Rust on the spot there as we go back to what will be the race lead once the two or three cars in front of them have made their compulsory stops. Murphy currently fourth on the track, Bright fifth, Ambrose sixth, but they will move up to be the race leaders, and this is a hell of a battle, because keep in mind, Greg Murphy and Jason Bright are in contention for second in this championship. Now, as a result of Jason Bright losing 20 points for his collision with Murphy, Surface Paradise, the gap between them now is only 15 points. So Greg Murphy well in contention to break HRT's long-established wish to have a 1-2 in the championship.
That's right. Just to clarify exactly that situation, there was a gap there that we knew about, and the officials hadn't really adjusted the points with the extra 20 to take off Jason Bright. By the time that's all done, the championship points now stand like this. 2064 for Scaife, so you can forget about the title because that's already gone. What Mark's talking about is 2 and 3. 1376 versus 1361, so there's only 15 points in it for second and third. Richards and Ambrose really need to make up some big time points to start catching them. Can Greg Murphy win the overall round here and in the process stop Holden Racing Team from getting that 1-2. There's still another round to go, so there's still plenty of points on offer. But you just get the feeling that Jason Bright is determined to fight really hard, not just to stop Greg Murphy winning this weekend, but to also stop him from claiming that HRT 1-2 that they so desperately want. At the moment, Murph versus Bright. They both got clear road and clear skies as well.
This place being so tough on tyres, it's really going to come down to good chassis setup and good driver strategy trying to make those tyres live. This track surface very smooth. The tyres, drivers say they don't actually wear out. It's just the fact that they get hot. That makes them very spongy and very greasy. You have to back off to try and get them back to a workable temperature. We saw Jason Bright struggling with that in race two, the car getting very sideways as he tried to hunt down the opposition. Rusty?
Well, Steve, the initial indications were that the car may have overheated on the run back into pit lane, but the actual hit was so hard that it's punctured the radiator. Is that right?
Yeah, it's quite disappointing, actually, but the tyres have hit the car that hard that the radiator's got a big hole in it. A few of the hoses are split, and it's put us out of the race, so it's a bit unfortunate. We'll go on great guns. I don't know where I was, but I'd made up quite a few spots. Just really happy with the car, and we were pretty confident of a pretty big result in that race, and we were looking for it, but unfortunately, once again, someone got him away.
Fingers crossed for Sandow.
Oh, I hope so. Thanks.
There's been an amendment down here in pit lane for races two and three involving just the entry over there. You can see the officials have built what can be described as a traffic island. They found that in the first race that a lot of the drivers were cutting it so fine to spend as little amount of time in pit lane as possible that they're actually driving through the Kmart Racing Team's pit. Now, that was a safety concern. So what they've done is they put that island there. It has made it a little bit tight for the Kmart team to get in, but there's nothing these teams won't do to try and minimise the time in pit lane.
Well, while you're talking, Grant, Mark Scaife has gone off.
Average under brakes after all that.
He's saying that the tyres were average under brakes, so he's gone off at Holden hairpin and collected.
Come in, mate. This chock is full of dirt.
Yeah.
Chock is full of dirt.
A whole heap of dirt for his trouble. They're going to have to clear that out. So he started back in 28th position, and he'd worked his way right up through the field, but now he's starting to slide all the way back down the rear. So Mark Scaife, the bad luck that plagued him in race two and put him out with an engine problem has now sprung back and got him again in race three on lap 16 of 54. That is good news for this man.
Well, puts him in Greg the box Murphy. Seat. Yep, he puts him in the box seat to win the round overall for the second year in a row. He hasn't had a clean sweep this time. He's had to take a back seat to Scaife on pole position and victory in race one. But at the moment, he's got 195 points for the round. Bright, 148. So Greg Murphy looking very well positioned here to make it two from two. Now, we've just heard from pit lane, the HRT boys are telling Scaife to pack it in.
Just down here, guys, there's lots of dirt, obviously, in the intake of car one. Also, point of interest for you, Craig Lowndes' car, when it came past, wasn't sounding very good at all, so possibly a problem for the 00 Motorsport Ford. We might try and get a word here from Mark Scaife, but he looks as though he is getting out of the car, boys, is he?
Oh, there's a big battle going on here, Rusty. It's getting pretty hot and heavy too. Oh, a little bit sideways. You can see the number two car snap sideways there as he tried to get 600 horsepower to the ground. Mark Scaife, we hear, has stepped out of the car. He is out of this race. The weekend that promised so much has ended disastrously for the five times series champ. You can see they're walking back into the garage. And that is the end of the weekend for Scaife. So the order at the moment, Brad Jones is still leading this one, but he's still yet to make his compulsory stop. Only 18 seconds up the road from Greg Murphy. Darryl?
Yeah, Glenn Seaton's just come into pit. If you have a look at the back of the car here as the guys come around, you can see it's copped quite a big whack, and it's amazing he stayed out so long. But the other problem he told the mechanics is that it was stuck in fourth gear. But at the moment here, he's got his foot off the brake, and it's in gear, and these guys got a problem. The jack has been torn out of his hand.
Yeah, well, there's all sorts of mayhem down there. You can hear crew members screaming at each other, trying to get their man back into action as soon as possible. You can see what Darryl was pointing out there, a massive hit in the left rear corner.
Well, Greg Murphy continues to lead away because Brad Jones, even though he's in front of him, is yet to pit. Let's take a look at your Shell Helix race score. It'll be changing by the second. There you go. Murphy has now officially gone up to position number one. Jason Bright second. Marcus Ambrose third. That's the timing sheet as it happens here at Pukekohe Raceway, the V8 International, the Boost prepaid mobile international. We're having a ball. Hope you're enjoying it on Network 10 and, of course, TV1 throughout New Zealand. Our Trans-Tasman adventure. Come back and join us after this. As race three continues, Mark Scaife is out of this one. Can Greg Murphy win the round overall for the second year running? Under safety car conditions after Cameron McConville went off, they've cleared off car number three, but boy, some dramas as safety car's been lapping around. Craig Lowndes' day is over. He has pulled out. Jason Bright has had to come in and change over his gear lever, of all things.
Yep,
as the gear dramas linkage, continue.
Gear linkage problem in car two. So Holden Racing Team have had a disastrous day so far.
But back to business we go. The car pulls away and the race restarts. Greg Murphy is in the lead and Marcus Ambrose is now in second position. Todd Kelly and Rick Kelly are third and fourth, but Glenn Seaton is jammed in there. He's a lap down at the moment, so that's not racing order that you're seeing. The racing order, in fact, is Murphy, Ambrose, Kelly and Kelly. Stephen Richards is in fifth. That's the fight for the lead. Car number 51.
Isn't Rick Kelly having a super day for the Holden Young Lions team up there in fourth? 19-year-old kid mixing it with the biggest names in the business. He's really come on in 2002. And here's the man in second, the highest placed of the Fords. Marcus Ambrose deep under brakes into Holden hairpin. That's the man he's got to catch, Greg Murphy. But Murphy's on fire here. His main opposition from Holden Racing Team have both fallen by the wayside. And now he's got a clear track in front of him and the New Zealand fans cheering him on.
John Bow has moved all the way up to sixth position. He's going for another top 10 finish. It'd be his fifth of the year. On board we go with the Castrol Commodore of Russell Ingall, who's holding down eighth at the moment.
This is great for Greg Murphy too in his fight with HRT in the championship. It was just 15 points between himself and Jason Bright. But when they came into this race, and with Bright dropping way down the order, Murphy is perfectly placed to get a big jump on Bright with one round remaining in the championship. It's going to spoil Holden Racing Team's party of a 1-2. That's what they want.
It's always good to see the movers on our PlayStation 2 race score. And you can see there that David Bernard's moved up 13 positions. And Garth Tander has moved up 14 since the start. Larry Perkins has picked up 16 places. And John Faulkner in car number 46 started 27th, is now up to 15th.
Look at David Bernard, he's had an up-and-down sort of weekend. And you can see, as Darrell Beattie pointed out earlier on, he's moved his way back after a problem to get his way up into the top 10. He's in 10th position, in fact. So the Caltechs, Haviland Ford, going up and down the result sheet like a yo-yo, but looking strong in this final run. So the order, Murphy, Ambrose, Todd Kelly, his brother Rick Kelly, Stephen Richards, John Bow up in sixth. Then it's Ingall, Stephen Johnson did well too to climb his way back from adversity. Tony Longhurst, David Bernard in 10th. You're riding with the enforcer, Russell Ingall. He's in 7th spot, John Bow in 6th. Dunlop in-car camera gets it into 6th gear. Full throttle, 270 kilometres an hour. We can see the aerodynamic lift on the bonnet there. The car is going at such a high speed. Seaton gets right out of the way and gives these leading cars racing room. John Bow goes through. Russell Ingall right up behind him. Tony Longhurst, Stephen Johnson in there too. Here's a comparison. The last five lap times between the first and second place cars. And you can see Ambrose on three of those five occasions quicker than the Kmart Commodore.
Oh, look at this, the better electrical car. They're going to go three wide into turn one. Stephen Johnson's there. Bernard just went right around the outside while Johnson and Tony Longhurst, it looks like, were dicing for position going down the front there. So Ford versus Ford versus Ford. Then you've got another better electrical car and also Garth Tander or Jason Barguana. That's Tander locked in there with that fight as well. So that was fighting for a top 10 position. 8, 9 and 10 was that little fight there. And Bernard went straight around Johnson and Longhurst and bumped himself up a couple of places. Darrell Beattie.
Yeah, I just spoke to Ross Stone about the pace car time there, and he was saying, yes, it definitely was an opportunity for him to cool the rear tyres down for Ambrose, but normally it takes five laps after the start to get back up to speed again.
Well, this has been a disaster for the Holden Racing Team. Jason Bright getting back into the action after fixing that gear linkage problem, and he has retired.
not your day.
And he gets the word from crew chief Matty Crawford, it is just not your day, certainly retiring in a huge cloud of smoke. So David Bernard, no lack of courage from the Caltex Haviland Ford. You saw him take two positions as they swept through that daunting turn one. So he's really got his head down here, charging hard. He's in eighth position now. As joining us in the commentary box, Craig Lowndes, 00 Motorsport Ford.
How you going?
What took you out?
We actually had a... we lost a cylinder in the engine. We're not sure exactly what caused it or what actually is the problem, but we had engine problems, so the guys decided to sort of give it a day and put it away.
Plenty of action down here in the field. That's a really tight turn, and that one at the end of the back straight, doesn't it cause some dramas?
Well, it is. It's 268 kilometres an hour. You're hard on the hard cut in top gear, so physically can't go any faster down that back straight, and really to pull it up for a first gear corner, quite incredible.
Look at this battle here between the better electrical Ford and the Castrol Commodore, hard under brakes. Larry Perkins wants to argue. Goes right up the inside of Max Wilson and picks up a spot.
Robbie Crawford all smiles down at the Kmart race team, because with Bridie out, that's obviously, if Murph can stay where he is, moves him up to second.
Yeah, it certainly does, but it's still a long way to go when we've been in this position before and haven't really made it, so all fingers crossed.
Are you thinking about the championship at this stage?
Oh, for sure we are, but still a long way to go and see what happens at the end of the day.
Finish first you must finish, they say.
Most definitely.
Thanks, Grant. And you can see problems back in the pack here, Barguana, with everything locked up in the Valvoline Cummins Commodore.
I don't know how we got through that without taking somebody out. He just skidded his way through the Holden hairpin like it wasn't there. There's Neil Crompton still fighting away. He goes around the outside, extreme outside of Jason Barguana.
We didn't see Neil Crompton's pit stop, Craig. Did he have a problem there? Because he was very handily placed in the opening laps. He ended up back in 20th something.
Yeah, he had some problems early in the early laps going into turn five, which is that hairpin, first gear hairpin. He had some problems with brakes and put him back a bit further on.
Let's have a look at this replay. Look at Barguana. He's got everything locked up, smoke pouring from two or three tyres at one stage. Slid it into the corner backwards.
I wouldn't be surprised if he's actually flat spotted that front right. No. It was heavily smoking, so as you can see, they're laying some rubber trying to get some traction.
He's just found a new line through the hairpin, Lowndes.
Well, hey, if you can get through it, let's take it. Hey, another one.
Oh, look at this.
That's Larry Perkins.
Gee, there's some cars locking up down there. I guess it's a situation where the tyres now, the 12 tyres, they've got all getting pretty tired, if excuse the pun, and now they're starting to lock brakes as a result.
Well, they are, definitely. The first race there, today, we had no rear tyres left, so it was almost like a skating ring. And I can imagine these guys now having their second race today, doing another 54 laps, quite bad, quite torturing on the tyres around here.
When do you feel them go?
Quite early. This is obviously another replay.
Big trouble. Look, he just dented the back. Now he's done the front on those tyres.
He's done a 720 there too. He lost the rear before, head first into the tyre barriers at turn one and two throughout the mobile S's. So you can feel him go early.
Yeah, definitely. This is a very coarse circuit. Actually, the tyres, when they pulled them off my car this afternoon, almost remind us of being at Wanneroo. Very coarse texture circuit.
Here's one of your teammates, Rodney Forbes, third of the 00 Motorsport Falcons. Bonnet's up, and the boys are shaking their heads. That doesn't look too promising.
Well, yeah, unfortunately for the guys, done a great job this weekend. Our car was actually working very well that the last race just then, and for us, it was just a pity for the engine problem.
Oh, look at this battle. Larry Perkins has just thrown caution to the wind here. He's right in the thick of the action, going door-to-door with Garth Tander, Brad Jones in the Aussie Male Ford. Looking for an opportunity as well. This is the battle for 11th, 12th and 13th position.
And what about Tander? Shut the door on Brad Jones going flying down there. In race one, Lowndes, you had a pretty good dice with Brad Jones around that back straight, and we were commenting just how much straight line speed that guy's got. You saw it firsthand.
Yeah, they have. The Aussie Male guys have done a great job there, and you'll probably see it here. They got some good straight line sniff, and really for us, we're just doing the best we can with what we've got. We've got another spec engine that we'd like to put in the car for Sandown, which we will now, obviously, and we'll just see what that does.
And have you come up with a solution to plastic bags in the air inlet yet?
I'm sure we've all, we've had hundreds of emails and designs sent to our workshop telling us all about getting mechanical arms, ripping it apart and flipping it over. But look, it's just one of those races, unfortunately. That's just the way it goes.
Look at this, Brad Jones, he's really got a move on. You saw that horsepower in a straight line as he leapt out of turn three. Look at Larry Perkins right across the curbing, had a big slide and gathered it up right at the last minute. So Brad Jones now closing in on the back of the Castrol Commodore. Looks like Larry's tyres are starting to get a bit slippery there, Craig.
Well, the first set of tyres, what they've got on now, the rears will go off before the fronts. I guess I shouldn't say that, depending on what the car setup's like. But for us, the rears went away earlier than the front. So as you can see for Larry there, coming onto pit straight, it's quite an interesting little corner.
Well, look at the rear of Jason Barguana. That'll be a result of that hairpin.
Well, it could be. Very lucky to get back there without any panel damage, really, because these guys, as you can see, a lot of tyre debris sort of flapping around there.
Look at this battle as they weave their way through the slower traffic. John Fortner giving way. Larry Perkins now is heading into pit lane. He's cut a tyre as well.
No, that's actually Russell Ingall. So Larry went shooting past. Gartander takes the outside line on there, and Ingall's front left is gone.
Now, we're hearing from pit lane that Greg Murphy also has a flat tyre.
Oh dear, Rusty, can help us with that one, Greg.
Well, just monitoring the radio, it sounds like the left front has gone. It was a panicked Greg Murphy that was on the radio. The Kmart team look as though they are standing by. Is there tyre dramas developing here? Car 8, Russell Ingall. Maybe he has a problem. Stephen Richards is coming in as well. So there's lots of action in pit lane, and most everyone has done their compulsory stops.
Well, there's action on the track too, Rusty. We can confirm that tyre problem for Murphy. Ambrose has gone through. His teammate Todd Kelly has gone through. And there is Greg Murphy in trouble. Looks like a flat front left tyre.
Well, safety car conditions, the yellow flag is out, and Greg Murphy comes in.
Hey, mate, no problems. We're ready for you.
Well, John Powell, front left two for him, but there's a lot of damage around there, so he's collected something,
David Bernard.
And David Bernard has collected the wall. That would have been really high speed.
Could well have been between those two cars. They would have been roughly on the same part of the track.
Yeah.
So we'll find out about that. Here is Russell Ingall. He cut that left front tyre. This place has gone berserk. Murphy in for the same drama. Grant?
Yeah, we're only really talking about how it's improved his championship position, but only opted to change the one. The front left tyre was the damaged tyre, and it's amazing how many cars are now coming in running on three wheels.
Gee, there's been a spate of tyre failures, Lancey. What are you putting your finger on that?
Well, I'm not sure. A lot of it's due to lock-ups, so we just have to wait and see. The tyres have been moved. We saw Glenn Seaton move those set of tyres into turn two. I don't know whether there's any bolts or anything sticking up out of the ground there.
John Powell, he's had some contact there. He's trying to find out whether it was a collision between himself and David Bernard, because Bernard was on a charge into that top ten.
That front design there may actually help him turn the thing in.
A little bit more front. Downforce. A little bit more angle of attack, and much better for the sponsors as well. So, John Bowe rejoins. Let's have a look at this incident. This was after. So
David Bernard's nowhere to be seen because Bernard crashed further up. So John Bowe's front left gives way. We'll try and find out exactly what happened to car number 9 and why he ended up in the wall. Glenn Seaton has had more troubles than he cares to wish for around here. He's right back in the list. Marcus Ambrose is now our race leader. It's him versus Todd Kelly. Rick Kelly still hanging in there. So too is Stephen Johnson. Max Wilson and Larry Perkins have been the big movers throughout that top eight. Neil Compton is in eighth position in car number 27. Dean Canto, his first drive in the 600 car, is up into a top 10 spot, and so too is Paul Wheel. Wow, what a situation at Pukekohe, but there's more racing ahead. Food, wine, and fun. They are the three essential ingredients of any Auckland experience. To go with the food, Auckland produces a number of award-winning wines from its 80-plus vineyards. And it is, of course, the place to indulge in the best shopping, nightlife, and arts in the country. And this summer, it is also the place to party. Now, thousands will be converging on this waterfront for the Louis Vuitton Challengers Series and, of course, yachting's holy grail, the America's Cup. You've probably heard about it. Make sure you check it out if you come to Auckland, the Viaduct Harbour.
Lights are out on the safety car. We're about to go back to racing. Marcus Ambrose at the front of the queue. Then he's got the Kelly gang behind him. Todd and Rick. This is a replay of Glenn Seaton's car going over the spike. Here's another one, John Bowe.
Yeah, one of the problems, we were trying to work out exactly why we were getting so many flat tyres. See that spike right there? That was holding the tyre barrier together. Now, the officials have got the sledgehammer and everything to that to get rid of it. That tyre barrier was wiped out by two cars. We are restarted and underway, and our new race leader is Marcus Ambrose. That's Todd Kelly behind him. Then it's Rick Kelly. Max Wilson is in fourth. Larry Perkins fifth. Dean Canto's in sixth. And Neil Crompton has now slid back on that timesheet that we've got there. We'll update that for you and check out exactly where he is. So back under race conditions. The spike has been removed. We shouldn't have too many flat tyre problems now, but we've certainly found out the answer. They did that while we're under safety car conditions. There's Cromley. He's come back in.
I think he's a lap down now as a result of those problems. Showing 37 laps on our timing screen. First of the cars to go a lap down in the queue.
I think he's more worried about our dinner arrangements.
Look at this. We've got a Ford leading a V8 supercar race. Something we have not seen a lot of in season 2002. Rusty?
Well, Mark, I can tell you that spike which was exposed has really been quite bad for the Castrol Racing team. Both Russell Ingall and Steve Richards suffered dramas. Now, have a look at this. This is the left front of Russell's car. He had quite a bad flat spot at the end of the back straight, but then when he hit that bolt or that spike where the tyres were held down, have a look at the aftermath from that. Dunlop do make very good tyres, but it's asking a lot for them to sustain that, isn't it? Goodness me.
I think so. They're not bulletproof, and I think Greg Murphy was another driver to succumb to the spike sticking out of the curb there. Shattering moment for the Murph. Was leading this one. Had to come in for a late tyre change. So Marcus Ambrose now is the leader, and the Ford fans have gone berserk here. It's been a long time since we've seen a Falcon in the lead. Holding the 123 of the races, Ford only two. Can Marcus Ambrose try and improve on that this afternoon? Look at the field here, down toward the back. Everyone pushing and shoving, jostling for position. Russell Ingall, car eight. As Brad Jones in the Aussie Mail Falcon. Anthony Trapp, car 75, the Toll Express Ford. So Marcus Ambrose, he's got a real job to do here. Try and hold out Todd Kelly in the Kmart Commodore. Rick Kelly just behind him in the Holden Young Lions machine. Then Max Wilson, the Brazilian, having one of his strongest performances in a race so far. This is looking out the back of Marcus Ambrose's car. Yes, he is the race leader. And can he sustain this pace to the end? Here the car on the hard cut, the rev limiter, running right out to the end. The 7,500 RPM rev limit in sixth gear. You cannot go any faster than that. Ambrose getting good drive out of turn three, carrying that speed all the way down the back straight. Here's Todd Kelly. Todd, we're looking for a good points haul here too. After race two, there was 40 points between himself in sixth and Stephen Richards in fourth. There has been a desire to get four TWR Australia Commodores into the top four positions of the championship. So Todd needs a good run here to make that happen. Rick Kelly has really started here this afternoon. Just 19 years of age, and the Holden Young Lions Commodore has been making rapid improvement throughout the season. Now, really in the thick of things.
Well, if he stays like this in third position, it'll be the first time that Rick Kelly has been on the podium in a V8 supercar race. What an extraordinary young man. Talented driver out of a very talented family. Darrell Beatty.
David, I guess you worked your way up. You come up to about 10th or 11th, then you had the flat, you dropped back, you worked your way back up again. What a drive, but then unfortunately the crash.
Yeah, it's been the story of the weekend, unfortunately. Slow pit stop yesterday while we were running second. This morning we had the thing stuck in gear while we were running well. And now, I'm not sure if it was tyre or if there's something with the car. Not real sure what went wrong, but something broke, so... who knows? You know, it could have been a tyre. There's been a lot of flat tyres. Either way, it just went straight ahead into the fence, and I'll tell you what, that fence wasn't soft.
You all right, though?
Yeah, well, you know what it's like, Darrell. You've had a few bingles in your time, and shake yourself off and go again.
Thanks, mate.
Thank you.
Oh, problems here for Stephen Richards, and he's bogged it too, and the gravel just went straight off on the entrance to turn three.
They may even bring another safety car out to get that car out of that gravel trap.
It's in a pretty vulnerable spot, isn't it, Craig?
It is actually just leading onto the back straight.
Wall coming onto the straight.
Well, Marcus Ambrose has worked hard to try and open a gap, but look at car 51. The Kmart Commodore Murphy is flying. Safety car is on the circuit. So they're going to have to pull that Castrol Commodore out of there. And Greg Murphy making good progress at the moment. He's up to eighth. And at the moment, he's sitting second in points for the day, depending on how Marcus Ambrose fares here. Greg Murphy still in contention to win the day overall. Just depends how he goes on these remaining laps and what happens to Marcus Ambrose. At the moment, Ambrose is sitting on 182 points, Murphy on 173, and Todd Kelly on 141. So could we see a change of result here?
Well, this would definitely help him, for sure, because it's really, you know, if the race had gone on the way it had, Marcus Ambrose probably and the rest of the guys would have sprung out, but really now Murph has been able to catch up. So a lot of his hard work is now done for him. Yeah, we just got to do the best bit and pass some cars.
There's his teammate, Todd Kelly.
Marcus Ambrose, under safety car conditions, is our race leader. Then it's the two Kellys, Todd and Rick. Max Wilson in the better electrical Ford Falcon is looking for his best race finish in his V8 supercar career. Dean Canto also has moved up 19 positions.
Wow.
Paul Wheel is in eighth, and our top 10 is now rounded out by Cameron McLean in the VIP Pet Foods car. This is Pukekohe in New Zealand in the V8 Supercar Championship. Welcome back as we take another quick trip in and around Auckland. Now, just 30 minutes from downtown, you'll find some pretty wild surf beaches and some idyllic holiday islands as well. Now, Aucklanders are a lot like us. They spend a lot of time outdoors, and of course, they love the water. Now, Auckland quickly became a popular home for New Zealand's indigenous people, the Maori, and many of their artifacts are housed in the Auckland Museum.
Well, Stephen Richards' car has been retrieved from the gravel trap at Pukekohe Raceway. Back in pit lane, the team effecting repairs. Lights are out on the safety car after the officials were able to rescue the Castrol Commodore. We're going back to racing once again. Marcus Ambrose leading the pack. Todd Kelly in second. Rick Kelly in third. Wilson, Perkins, Canto, Murphy back in seventh. Car 51. And a number of laps spent behind the safety car is time lost for Murphy, trying to improve his position as the cars build up ahead of steam, back toward the start finish line, and we're back to racing.
Here we go again, and it's come down pretty much to an 8-lap dash to the finish. Across the line they go, Ambrose with Todd Kelly behind him, and Rick Kelly also on the hammer as well, through turns one and two. That's where the stake was that was causing problems.
Great performance from Dean Canto up there in sixth place in the Caterpillar 40. Wouldn't have expected to be that high early in the weekend. So he's up there in the top six, but Greg Murphy is coming up right behind him, and Murphy really has to make up as many positions as he can if he's going to be in contention for the podium.
Guys, just have a closer look at this. I've been talking to the Dunlop guys. This is a closer look at the left front of Russell Ingall's car. There is the puncture mark from the stake that's gone right through the tyre. You can see in this area here down towards the front where the tyre has actually collapsed through the sudden loss of air. But the problem they are worried about is 16 tyres they have found have all suffered the same fate. This exact same curvature is a reflection of the stake where it's punctured the tyre. What they're worried about right now is how many other cars ran over it that perhaps yet haven't suffered a tyre deflation.
Yeah, could be a question. There might be a real time bomb out there with some of those tyres. Greg Rust on the spot. Here's our team, Brock.
What a wild spin.
Shattered front spoiler for Craig Bell.
He was in a top 10 race position there too. He was about eighth or ninth coming around to complete that lap. So Craig Baird, the Kiwi, had a wild ride,
head
and then
front damage, over.
Boom.
So Greg Murphy is a few cars back from this battle. His teammate Todd Kelly, though, well in contention for a race win. Let's have a look at the replay. Craig Lowndes.
Here he is, trapped in the middle there at Holden Hairpin.
Oh, got a biff. It might have been from the VIP Pet Foods car.
And John Bow, head first, into Bow, into Baird's car. It's another angle of it. Nowhere to go.
No, unfortunately, it's a corner that you can easily get tagged. I know that for a fact. But I'm looking at John Bow. He's running around the circuit. There is smoke coming out of his car, so I'm not sure whether he'll be pitting this lap as well.
He's already had a big hit. He's just taken another one right in the front of the car. Grant Denyer.
The bad news for Craig Baird now is he has a leaking radiator. As a result of that contact, he won't resume. But John Bow will be coming in. The guys have four new tyres to put on that car as well. That's their fifth stop for that team.
Well, I can tell you, overall on the championship points for the round, Greg Murphy is edging closer and closer to Marcus Ambrose in terms of winning the overall round. We'll just watch this pit stop and then I'll explain it for you. This is Garth Tander comes in.
Greg Murphy is pushing his way through the field. John Bow is in trouble. Saw him limping past our commentary box. Car 888 and all sorts of dramas. Here's our race leader, Marcus Ambrose. Todd Kelly in second. Rick Kelly in third. And it's Perkins doing a great job.
And Greg Murphy's in fifth now. As far as overall points go for the round, look at John Bow. That's a sorry sight. Marcus Ambrose currently has 182 points for the round. If he remains in that spot, he'll finish ahead of Greg Murphy. But Murphy, back in fifth, has now collected 179 points. We'll have to sort it out when they finish, but Marcus Ambrose is holding on and holding on for an overall round victory. If Greg Murphy can make his way up another position or so, he should do enough to complete a round victory here at Pukekohe for the second year running. Larry Perkins right up there in fourth position.
So the tail light hanging out of the back of the Castor Oil Commodore. Larry has really been on fire this weekend. Really loves this Pukekohe Raceway. Spent a lot of time here racing in various categories, including open wheelers earlier in his career. And now he's really stepping up to the battle. Look at this, right on the limit as he brakes hard. There's Greg Murphy. Car 51, you can see he's giving it everything under brakes. Murph on a charge, up in fifth spot. Pushing hard to try and get the top podium position here this afternoon.
One of the better electrical cars went off out the back door there. Probably was Max Wilson. Yes, it was. Missed the hairpin completely, but rejoins the race.
So the order, Ambrose, Todd Kelly, Rick Kelly, Larry Perkins. You can see this battle here between the Holden Young Lion and the veteran in the Castrol Commodore. Murphy's up to fifth. Canto's in sixth. Paul Wheels done well in the K&J thermal machine. He's up to seventh. Cameron McLean in the VIP Pet Foods car, eighth. Brad Jones, ninth. Stephen Johnson, tenth.
Well, there's been some sort of problem for John Faulkner. He came in to fix a tyre, and as he's come in, the car's dropped back down. It looks like it's actually just burst another tyre on the front left. It's now dropped down on its guts on the front left corner.
Huge blowout for our race leader, Marcus Ambrose, at the hairpin, and the crowd go wild because that will put Greg Murphy in position overall for this round. A huge, huge blowout from the Pertec Ford in the front right has gone on that one.
It's interesting, it's on the right-hand side of the car. There were some suspects about that spike on the curbing hitting the left, but that's a right failure. You know the Stone Brothers team will be shattered by that. That moves him down the order. Todd Kelly now goes to the race lead. Rick Kelly in second, Larry Perkins.
Check out the vibrations on the wheel there. He's just holding on, trying to control this beast of a car that's shaking around, and that just rattles your bones, and he's gone off.
I was going to say, Craig, looked like he was off cross-country there. Oh, look at this. Problems here for the VIP Pet Foods machine. So too, Junior Johnson. So right at the end, with a number of well-placed Fords, it's all gone haywire.
Shake for Marcus Ambrose.
Trying to lift the car back to pit lane. So too, car 17. So two of the top Fords go out in a matter of only a few moments. So it's Commodores 1, 2, 3, 4 at the front of this pack. Let's have a look at the replay. Look at that. That's a frightening moment, Craig Lowndes.
Well, it is, especially when you're only trying to stop on three wheels. He did a great job to keep it on the black stuff. It's a damn pity. It's a damn shame, really, for Ford. Marcus had a strong car this weekend. He was going along quite nicely. As Ross said, he did flat spot it, and that's probably what the cause was.
These guys run a hell of a lot of negative camber on the front of the car to get good turn in, and maybe that's been too much for the tyres under heavy braking.
No, I wouldn't have thought so. I would have thought, these cars all run pretty close to the same. We all run slightly differently, but these tyres are designed to put up with it. And Marcus is continuing on, so he must be trying to get to the finish.
Limping around with a damaged tyre. Look at this attack. Up the inside by Larry Perkins. He gets him too.
He got him right on the door. He got Rick Kelly and he squeezed past. Larry drops into second position. The veteran refuses to give up against the young charger in Rick Kelly.
Now you can ignore Russell Ingall, who's in that pack. He's a lap down, car eight, but Larry Perkins is well in contention here. The order, Todd Kelly, Larry Perkins and Rick Kelly.
Yeah, Todd Kelly takes the race victory, but in the end, Greg Murphy takes the overall round victory. So really a double success day for the Kmart Racing team. Car number 15 wins race 3, but overall, Greg Murphy, the local Kiwi, has done
done it again at Pukekohe.
Well, wasn't that amazing? Toward the end of there, Marcus Ambrose giving him a real battle for the top spot on the podium as Stephen Johnson limps his way back. But Greg Murphy's done it. 186 points. He'll take the top points haul from the day, and that's two from two for the king of Pukekohe.
Amazing finish. That was just incredible. You ever seen anything like that? Just shredded tyres left, right and centre, people spearing off.
It's quite amazing, really. Marcus would be really, I reckon, he'd be shattered. It's just like two laps away. Here he comes across the line.
Can't take a trick, can they?
Unbelievable, really. He did a tremendous job, stayed out of trouble, made one slight error with maybe a flat spot, but really that car was a quick car this weekend and deserved to win.
So here comes car 15, Todd Kelly, winner of race three.
That's his first race win for the season, Todd Kelly. He's been rewarded for consistency. And listen to the crowd.
Brad Dania.
Well, Rob Crawford, you take them as you can get them, but you need that kind of stress.
Oh, no, I don't really. It's just good that it's our first 1-2 ever for the Kmart Racing team. And it's just a credit to all the guys back at TWR at home and all the TWR staff here and the Kmart Racing team. It's fantastic.
It's an awesome result. Well done.
Thanks very much.
He's talking 1-2 overall because while Todd Kelly won the race, Greg Murphy won the round. Overall, Murphy wins it with 186 points for the weekend. Kelly second with 157. And Rick Kelly, the youngster, well, he came in fourth because Marcus Ambrose slotted in third overall with 125. Oh, what an incredible end to a remarkable race here in Pukekohe. These are the race three results. Todd Kelly, the victor. Larry Perkins in second and Rick Kelly third for race three. Gee, there were some big movers there. Larry Perkins easily the best mover. Probably his last drive here at Pukekohe. The next time he comes back will be as a team boss only. We'll take a break and sum it all up for you at the end of an extraordinary day in New Zealand. It's the first time in championship history that Kmart has gone 1-2 overall in a round. And look at the jubilation from the Kiwi Greg Murphy and his teammate Todd Kelly. What a day, an extraordinary day, a tough day at the office for all the drivers, all the teams, and of course all the tyres as well. Let's hear from our overall winner, Greg Murphy.
Well, at the end of the most remarkable race, Greg Murphy, 2 years in a row, you are the king of Pukekohe. How does that feel?
Mate, how did we do that? I don't know. That was just unbelievable, and for Todd to win the race as well, fantastic. So many things went on, so many punctures, Marcus, on it with, a lap to go, a lap and a half to go. It was just the most phenomenal race. I never thought this could be possible after having to go through the pits after I got a puncture. So just totally blown away.
It's been a year of turmoil for the Kmart race team in some ways. We saw the dramas at Bathurst, the Queensland 500. Nice for you to come here and have a 1-2. That's wonderful.
Oh, it's just awesome. Awesome for Todd too. He hasn't had a great year either. We've both been struggling along, and obviously the disasters at Bathurst and Queensland. So it's great for the team. Kmart, Castrol, Holden, everything's just fantastic.
Coming right for you at the end of the season, mate. Bring it on for Sandow.
Just bring it on. I just got to bring all these people to Melbourne. I don't know. It's going to cost me a fortune.
Well done.
Thanks, mate. Cheers.
Todd Kelly, you missed the spike. You missed all the rubbish on the road. You must be the luckiest man alive.
Yeah, it wasn't a bad race. Obviously, the guys that were cutting the corner by quite a bit were the ones that were penalised by the flat tyres. So I was trying to keep off the grass a bit, so I didn't get a stop go. And, the car was a lot better in the last race. We struggled a little bit early on, but it's good to have a Kmart 1-2. It's fantastic.
Marcus, you were one of the best men out there this weekend, but motorsport can be cruel.
Yeah, look, it's one of those days, I was trying to win the race, and it's been a long time between drinks, And I was just pushing hard, and I don't know what happened out there, whether I locked up or the tyre went down, but, just a cruel result, really. But, we've shown speed, that's a good thing, and, I've enjoyed the weekend.
See you at Sandown.
Yeah, let's hope for better luck, eh?
Thanks, mate.
Thank you.
Who would have thought that today would finish the way it did? We thought that the rain would come down on us, but in fact it was clear skies and there's only champagne to come down for Greg Murphy. This is how they finished overall for the round.
Car number 51 of Greg Murphy with 186 points. Todd Kelly claims second on the podium with 157. And Marcus Ambrose, as you saw, lost out on luck in race three to finish third overall. What a great performance from the youngster Rick Kelly there to finish fourth overall, and also a good one from Larry Perkins. Now, the championship points at the top of the table haven't changed, and they won't change because Mark Scaife is our series champion. But Greg Murphy has now leapfrogged Jason Bright into second position. And at the moment, that Holden Racing Team 1-2 has been split up by the Kmart Commodore. Todd Kelly has jumped up one position also from when he started. He's in fourth. Then Richards, Marcus Ambrose, Craig Lowndes, Russell Ingall, David Bernard and Garth Tander. The difference now is 27 points in favour of Greg Murphy in the fight for second position overall in the championship. Where are we off to next? The final round of the V8 Supercar Championship for 2002. Is at one of the most famous tracks that we've got, the V8 Ultimate at Sandown. Hope you can join us for that one Saturday, the 30th of November, and Sunday, the 1st of December. If it's anything like today, we're in for a thrilling finale to this season. That is it from Pukekohe, the day that Greg Murphy made it back-to-back overall wins at his home track. I'm Matthew White. Thanks for watching our coverage here on Network 10. Thanks to all our crew here in New Zealand. We'll see you at Sandown.
Okay.